Welcome back to this, today's episode of The Pen is Mighty.
Groping for the truth.
Up the jumper of speculation. And today on the show, we've been doing sex. Not literally, of course, this isn't Channel 4. I'm Jeb.
And I'm Joe Seldom.
Don't forget, later on in the show, we'll be talking to a bearded child. Now, we were all young once, of course, although most of us didn't have beards at the time. But whilst some of us may have aged more hideously than others, there's no doubt we can all remember our own sexual awakening.
Filled with the first flush of youth, it was a complicated time for us all. For some, it was first love. For others, a period of confused preferences and unwholesome experimentation, the precursor to a lifetime of inadequacy. Jeb.
Yes, age broadens not only our hips, but our perspectives also. But how do young people today cope with the complexity of sex and sexual relationships? Here, with Youth in View, is somebody called Toxic Pizzle.
Hey, you should give a bigger for my homies in the house! Word up! So I was hanging in my crib, got my bits laying back easy. Give me some scally looking so fly. I'm set to get my max on getting down with the kitty and we's not got all. And Chrissy, she can scrap a lick and she ain't even sham. But my old lady, she skank, I'm knocking, give it a lap. You don't got no respect, so I get my strap, say I peel your cap, woman. But my bitch, she bag up, say I'm ghost and bail. Bitch, just a sack chase, I go find my cars and I'm skitzing. Go wake that chicken head cave boy, bust some slugs from my chrome. So I was taking up north trip, putting on them county blues. So be advised, brother, don't go knocking boots with no trick, you'll be tripping and you end up a bomber like a banger and you lose your bank. That's it, I got a bounce or I get gaffer with the jigs. Yeah.
No, I'm not having it. Well, I was under the impression he spoke English for a start. Now, some of us are gifted with the good looks, charm and affluence to guarantee a high turnover of totty.
But for the vast majority of the population, finding love and companionship is more of a struggle. And for really ugly or dull people, it's an almost insurmountable challenge.
Our video diarist, Thelma Bernstead, faces just such a challenge. She's resorted to contacting a dating agency. And we join her now as she prepares herself for her first blind date.
I am here in my bedroom where I have been trying on outfits for my date tonight with a man called Frank, who is a widower on account of the fact that his wife did shoot herself because she could not stand his breath. I am not wearing no knickers, as I have been informed that a gentleman does sometimes wish to shag a lady behind bins, and that underpants can be an encumbrance if such an eventuality arises. Also, I have been learning how to be applying a condom, for I do not wish to fall pregnant or catch a case of crusty muff. As I do not have a penis, I have been practicing on the dog. Unfortunately, in so doing, I did cause the dog to suffocate. If Frank does decide to shag me behind some bins, I shall be asking him to reimburse me for the dog. I am now at the restaurant where I have arranged with Frank where to meet. He did sound quite pleasant on the telephone, although it was a bit difficult to understand what it was he was saying as he was eating a pickled onion. I must confess to being a little tad excited by the prospect of the romance, what may be developing tonight, and concerned as to whether these seat covers is washable. It is a little time later and Frank has not yet arrived. Also, in my excited state, I have been and forgotten to take my medication. What is a condition of my release? I have requested of the waiter to remove the cutlery from the table as I am not supposed to have access to metal implements. It is now 11 o'clock and the squirming little tosspot is not flaming.
Turned up, bastard!
This is a disappointment.
Kill him!
As you will appreciate.
Bastard!
I am feeling quite
tense
and have bloody
told him
to clear the restaurant.
You're all going to die!
I have now been brought home and sedated by a very nice ambulance lady who did also help me bury the dog before I agreed to put down the scissors and back away. I have been deciding to take a philosophical view of the outcomings of tonight's adventure and have been telling myself that I shall forgive Frank, of which I shall be informing him when I do go to see him in the morning.
A tragic story, although the good news is that Frank escaped with some of his major organs and is more or less not entirely dead.
Attempted homicide is one way of dealing with rejection, but whilst it might satiate the appetite for revenge, it doesn't necessarily represent a long-term solution.
So what can a vile old troll like Thelma do to improve her chances of getting lucky in love?
A wash and a shave would be a good place to start, but a more permanent solution might lie in the hands of the plastic surgeon.
It's a well-established fact that cosmetic surgery can do wonders for breasts, isn't that right, Joe?
Yes, although penile augmentation has proved to be something of a disappointment, don't you think, Jeb? But surgery can be dangerous and expensive and leave some people looking like they've been stapled to a wall, something our next guest can attest to.
Victoria Mung has the dubious honour of being Britain's fakest woman. Victoria, welcome to the show. Now, you've been under the surgeon's knife more than 400 times, is that correct? What?
And is this right? You claim to have spent almost £600,000 on these procedures. That's a staggering amount of money, isn't it? Would you say it's been worth it? Okay, well, we've got a picture here of how you looked before your first operation. This was 18 years ago, is that right?
I'm sorry, I can't understand a word of it.
Let's take a look at the picture.
Right, that's interesting. I mean, if you don't mind me saying so, you weren't much of a looker back in those days, but it has to be said, you've spent 600 big ones and ended up looking like someone shrink-wrapped their scrotum. What? Got Ligia? Pointless. Let's take a look at the weather.
I want to work for the BBC!
Looks like we've got a spot of rain on the way there.
Oh, Mammy, you really are an utter turd.
One thing which seems evident from tonight's programme is that many of the factors which determine our sexual and emotional success or failure lie far beyond our control.
I didn't want orange squash. I said orange and apple.
And sometimes nature twists the rules, something our next guest knows only too well.
For the love of
joining us
God,
now
woman.
Are Albert Sputtle and his mother, Vivian. Welcome to the show.
Hello.
And hello, Albert. How are you today?
He prefers Bertie.
I can speak for myself, thank you, Mammy. I'm not a moron.
Right. Well, Bertie, you're 7 years old, that's right, isn't it? It must be long past your bedtime, I should think.
What an utterly fatuous observation. Regardless of my personal routine, I happen to be a guest on your television programme, so my bedtime doesn't really factor into it, does it? If it did, then I wouldn't be here. I'd be in bed, and that wouldn't lend itself to a particularly successful interview, would it?
No.
Vivian, Bertie is clearly a very special little boy. Can you explain to us the nature of his condition?
There's no point asking her. She can barely remember the instructions of boiling an egg. I have a malady described as segmental progeroid syndrome, which is essentially a genetic vagary predisposing me to accelerated hormonal function, manifesting itself in the form of early physiological maturation, that is to say, puberty.
I'm right in saying, aren't I, Bertie, that this is something of a rare disease?
It's not a disease.
Fine.
Vivian, the physical symptoms are obviously quite pronounced. Have you considered strategies to perhaps help disguise some of the more unusual side effects?
Such as what?
A bag?
I'm sorry, I don't see your point here at all. Why on earth should I go to all the trouble of falsifying my appearance, hiding behind some misbegotten facade of normality, simply in order to satisfy a narrow-minded preconception of convention? I am who I am, and I make no apologies for my own idiosyncrasies.
Well, I think we could all learn a lesson from that.
Of course, if I happen to be a simpering dullard or an egocentric fathead, I might be more inclined to disguise the fact.
Meaning what?
Oh, nothing.
So, Bertie, besides having a beard, you're also gender-challenged, is that correct?
No.
You sure about that? You're not a little girl at all.
Oh, don't be pathetic.
Now, Vivian, how do you think this condition has affected Bertie socially?
Well, he does have some problems at school, actually. He's not terribly popular.
That's probably not so much to do with the beard, though, is it?
No, not really. He's actually quite obnoxious.
You said I was precocious.
Well, you say potato, I say big hairy girl.
Right, well, that's about all we've got time for this evening.
Shut it, Beardy.
We'd like to say thank you to all our guests for joining us. And, of course, thank you for watching.
We'll be back next week.
Not if my lawyer has anything to do with it.
Until then, a very good evening to you.
Good night.
Somebody get this little freak off me monitor.
I'm calling Esther Ranson.
Oh, I'm just shitting my knickers.